This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is a joy to be greeting you on this Sunday, August the 7th, 2022, the ninth Sunday after Pentecost and the first Sunday of the month of August. So as we worship here in the sanctuary, we welcome each and every one of you gathered here, and we welcome each and every one of you who are worshiping with us virtually online. God is spirit, and those who worship God must do so in spirit and in truth. So as we prepare to worship the living God, let us stand to our feet and join in our opening song, Holy, Holy, Holy. Shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house, Lord. I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. You may be seated as Dr. Shane K. Floyd comes to lead us in our opening prayer, and the Reverend Julio A. Dixon will read our scripture lesson and lead us through the Decalogue. Most loving.
just asking on this first Sunday that you would just simply look beyond all faults in this room today. God, we recognize that we all fall short of the glory of God, but we rest assured in knowing that your grace is sufficient. So come by here now, O God. Pass us not. Pass us not, O gentle Savior, hear our humble cry. While on others, thou art calling. Do not pass any one of us by. So now, God, as we come forward with inspired hearts and our minds focused on the cross, we just ask that in the name that stands above every other name, that wonderful name of Jesus, that you would just invoke the power of your Holy Spirit to rest, rule, and abide within each and every person that is here today. Oh, God, someone came here with a little bit of ailment within their limbs, and some came here with some emotional distress, but God, you know everyone in the room today, and simultaneously, we just ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would just touch every heart and every mind and every family that is represented here today. You are the remedy, Savior. You have everything within your blood that we are given today that will allow us to carry on and to see what the end is going to be. So now, God, allow a few cups to run over with your power. Allow a few cups to run over with your goodness. Allow a few cups to run over with your grace so that we may know without a shadow of a doubt that you are still God all by yourself. We need you in this hour. As we still stand in the midst of viruses and things that are designed to weigh us down and burden us, we recognize that someone didn't wake up this morning falling victim to one of these things, but you are still on the throne. Oh God, we just ask now that you would just simply touch us. Touch us in such a way that we recognize that if it had not been for you on our side, just where would we be? God, we just ask that you would just bless this pulpit and bless the preacher man of the hour. God, lift this pastor on high. Touch him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet that he will proclaim, thus saith the Lord today. And God, when it's all said and done, when we've been renewed and replenished by your blood today, we recognize that we have yet another chance, another opportunity to praise your holy and majestic name. God, we don't want any rocks crying out on our behalf because we know that you have been so good to us. So we're just going to just lift up our hands today and give you praise. We're going to lift up our hands today and say thank you. We're going to lift up our hands and say, oh God, you have brought us a mighty long way. And now, oh God, as we go forward in this service, take us higher. Place us in those spaces that we would be most affected, that you have called us to be a people who are called by your name. And we'll be ever mindful to give your name the honor, the glory, and the praise. For it is in the awesome and excellent one that we call Jesus that we give thanks and praise today. In his name we pray. Amen. Please stand for the scripture lesson. The scripture lessons come today from Isaiah chapter 1, verse 10 to 20. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the teaching of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifice, says the Lord. I have enough of burnt offerings, of rams, and the fat of fat beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or lambs or the he-goats. When you come to appear before me, who requires of you this trembling of my courts? Bring no more vain offerings. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath and the calling of assemblies, I cannot endure iniquity and solemn assembly. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, may my soul hate. They have recovered. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of burning them. When you are spread forth for your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even now, you make many prayers. I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourself. Make yourself clean. Remove the evil of your doing from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Correct oppression. Defend the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Come now. Let us reason together, say the Lord. Thou, your sins are like scarlet. They shall be as white as snow. Thou, they are red like crimson. They shall become like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. God's word to God's people, from all that dwell below the stars. Lord thy God, who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, thou shalt have no other God before me. First and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Thank you.
music selection from Sister Jan Munger.
Praise the Lord. Always good to be back in the house where my journey first began.
Lift up my eyes to
way of the melody was played,
soft and exquisite.
And the singer bring her heart to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you know, when we just stand and open our eyes and look at the stairs, and we know that our help comes from the Lord. Our help comes from God. And when we just close his name, we feel his power. We walk in his place. We can be sure that we protect.
Thank you, Sister Montgomery, for coming back home today to bless us and reminding us that our help comes from the Lord. The psalmist says, I will lift mine eyes unto the hills. Then he asks the question, from whence cometh my help? And then he answers it and says, my help cometh from the Lord. Is that somebody's testimony in the house today? Is that somebody's testimony online today? If it is, just type it in the chat. Just clap your hands and say, my help comes from the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. It is truly a joy, honor, privilege, and pleasure to stand before you once again behind the sacred desk and to be able to proclaim what thus saith the Lord. A special good morning to each and every one of you gathered here in our sanctuary, and a special good morning to each and every one of you who are worshiping with us virtually on Facebook Live and later on with our YouTube channel feed. Please be sure to follow us on Facebook and to like us on Facebook and to share our link with others. Say good morning to us in the chat and good morning to one another as we fellowship with each other virtually. And for those of you who watch on YouTube, please be sure to subscribe to our channel and like our channel so that we may share the good news with others. On this first Sunday of the month of August, our scripture lesson is taken from the Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah, chapter 1, verses 10 through 20. And in Isaiah, chapter 1, verses 10 through 20, we will pay particularly close attention to verse 16. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. I'd like you to think with me and pray with me this morning, church, on the theme relevant to our subject matter, wash yourselves. Let us pray. Lord, speak to me that I may speak the living echoes of thy tone, as thou hast sought, so let me seek thine erring children lost and alone. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Nearly 2.5 years into a global pandemic, we've seen the effects of germs and relied on the grace of God to see us through. In addition to our prayers, we have been vigilant in our efforts to be as sanitary as possible. Somebody ought to say amen. If you didn't say amen, I was going to run out of here. Praise God. See, hand sanitizers and dispensers are plentiful. They're part of the furniture nowadays. Disinfectant wipes are not a nice-to-have item. They're a must-have item. People who rarely wash wash their hands are washing them more frequently. Hallelujah, praise God. And one of the positive byproducts of the pandemic is an emphasis on best practices for hygiene and sanitation. But even with extreme caution, people are still falling ill. In other words, church, as much as we try, we cannot wash nor can we bleach our way out of the pandemic. Today's text, taken from the prophet Isaiah, speaks about washing. And this is not a washing to prevent the spread of germs. This is a washing that is intended to remove the dirt that has littered the souls of God's people, Israel. Admittedly, church, Isaiah, the first chapter, verses 10 through 20, is not easy reading, nor is it cheerful reading. The preacher, Reverend Dixon, and Dr. Floyd, the preacher, challenged on first glance to find good news to draw out of this text. However, I submit to you this morning that if you pray, the Holy Ghost will lead us to discover good news in the text. For in this text, God is clear that Israel is dirty and needs a good cleaning. God's problems with Israel are outlined in the first six verses of the text. Look at verses 10 through 15. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the teaching of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord? I've had enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of he-goats. When you come to appear before me, who requires of you this trampling of my courts? Bring no more vain offerings. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath and the calling of assemblies, I cannot endure iniquity and solemn assembly. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Now, it's hard to open the doors of the church on those verses, amen? But keep in mind, church, we're reading this text not deep into the book of Isaiah. This is only chapter one. This is in the beginning of the prophet Isaiah. And if you look at Isaiah, you can remember that Isaiah is a microcosm of sacred scripture, because Isaiah contains 66 chapters. The first 39 chapters are the book of judgment, and the last 27 chapters are the book of comfort. In the Old Testament, we have the law and the prophets, and then when we get to the New Testament, we have Jesus Christ. So here at the beginning of the prophet Isaiah, we see that God is not pleased, that there is a major theological and spiritual problem that the prophet of God must address. And even in these early verses of a book that contains 66 chapters, three themes of Isaiah are present right off the bat. Number one, sin. Somebody say sin. Second, the need for redemption. Somebody say redemption. And third, the hope of a coming new kingdom. Somebody say hope. So there's sin, there's redemption, and then there's hope. Somebody thinking about your own life and where God has brought you through, if you think about sin and redemption and hope, you can shout hallelujah right now. But let's not sugarcoat the text, because there's much within it that we must unpack today. See, as I said earlier, the first six verses, verses 10 through 15, the prophet does not paint a pretty picture. In fact, it is quite ugly. For here in the text, compared to Sodom and Gomorrah, two places destroyed by sin. And yet, Israel maintained its religious practices while falling deeper and deeper into sin. Do not miss that point, because that is a key point to this text. That Israel fell deeper and deeper and deeper into sin, and yet they continued their religious practices. God sees this, and he decides that he's had enough. He's had enough of Israel's rituals. He's had enough of Israel's sacrifices. He's had enough of Israel's burnt offerings. God looked down from heaven and saw Israel falling into sin and yet remaining with their religious practices. And he said that worship has become routine for Israel. They're just robots going through the motions. They maintained the proper form and rituals, but they were devoid of the Spirit. In other words, church, Israel's worship was no longer pleasing to God. Now, the newsflash for you this morning, church. Routine rituals without the Spirit's anointing mean nothing to God. Amen, Pastor Curtis. Fast forward to the New Testament in John, the 4th chapter, the 24th verse. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. One of the hallmarks of our AME church is our faithfulness to the traditional Methodist ritual. I stand before you today and say that John Wesley, Thomas Coke, Francis Asbury, and Richard Allen could walk into an AME church today and easily recognize the ritual. They would recognize the doxology. They would recognize the decalogue. They would recognize the gloria patri. They would recognize the communion ritual. Unlike other Methodist denominations, we at the AME Church have not veered away from the traditional rituals that we inherited from John Wesley and the Church of England. And I stand before you today as your pastor and say, that's a good thing. I appreciate the traditional ritual. However, we are not saved by the ritual. Well, you need to listen to me good this morning. There's no need to sing praise God from whom all blessings flow when you're full of praise to yourself and think you did it without any help from God. Don't waste your time reciting the Decalogue if your possessions are your false idols and nobody gets along with you because you don't love God and you don't love your neighbor as you love yourself. What I'm teaching you today is that your spirit must align with God's spirit for your worship to be acceptable in his sight. Many of you know, I try to play the organ. Notice I said try or play. Amen. And I can read music, but sometimes, Sister Gladys, you've got to add a few extra notes because the Holy Ghost gives you a few extra things that the original composer didn't give you. When you preach, you have your manuscript, but sometimes God will give you something that you didn't print out on the page. You can't be so wedded to the ritual that you don't allow the Holy Spirit to come in and have his own way. See, that's what Israel is missing in the text. And that is what leads to God's harsh words toward them. The good news is Israel did not forget to worship God, but they forgot why they worshiped God. And as a result, the purity of Israel's worship was defiled. My Holy Ghost imagination tells me that what God was really saying to Israel is, your dirty hands can't offer any sacrifice to me. Your dirty hearts cannot offer me any praise. Don't bring your dirty feet into my sanctuary. I don't even want to look at your dirty faces. Take your nasty smelling incense out of here because I don't want to is in the text, the Henry Curtis translation. That's what God is saying to Israel. That's the bad news. But here comes the good news. Somebody say good news. Somebody type in the chat, good news is coming. Because God, through his prophet, gives Israel a path back to him. Look at what it says in verses 16 and 17. He says, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, defend the fatherless, plead for the widow. God first says, wash yourselves. Somebody say, wash yourselves. Somebody type in the chat, wash yourselves. See, it doesn't get any clearer than that. If Israel has any hope of being clean, any hope of being righteous, any hope of being pure, any hope of being holy, Israel must first wash herself. And God gives the formula for the detergent. Say, well, Brother Pastor, where did you get that? Look at verse 17. Cease doing evil, learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, defend the fatherless, plead the widow, shake it up, stir, pour on yourself, and get yourself together. See, we may infer from the text that Israel was clearly not doing the things God prescribed for them to do. And thus we have the spiritual crisis outlined in the text. So on this first Sunday of August, this ninth Sunday after Pentecost, as we read this text and as we apply this ancient text to our current context, there is much for us to learn and to celebrate. See, sin stains. Sin stains us, but God makes a space for grace and makes a way for us to become clean. I'm glad that we don't have to wallow in the dirt of our sin, but God creates a space for us to go somewhere and get cleaned up. See, this text is something that somebody in this sanctuary or somebody watching us virtually needs to hear, because you need to be released from the dirt in your life. There are far too many people in the world who live with the guilt of past sin. They struggle daily to move beyond the pain that they cause to themselves and to others. And to make matters worse, there are people who remind them constantly of their sin. People who remind them of their sin without looking themselves in the mirror and repenting for their own sin. But the word of hope that I stopped by St. John to communicate to you today is that by God's grace and through the words of the prophet Isaiah, sin can be forgiven. You don't have to remain in the stain of your dirt and of your past. There's a way back for you to be washed and be made clean. Because the Bible tells us in the text that the dirty and the sinful, when presented to God, can by his grace be made clean. All of us are testimonies this morning that God has washed us up along the way. We haven't always put on our Sunday best and come to St. John. We haven't always worn white robes of splendor. We have dirt in our lives and sin in our lives, but God made a way for us to go somewhere and be washed and be made clean. And even though we are broken, even though we are sinners, by God's grace, we can come here and offer him an acceptable sacrifice of praise. By God's grace, we can come here and lift our eyes unto the hills, Lord, that our help comes from the Lord. By God's grace, we don't have to be guilty and fall for all in sin of what we did yesterday and last week and 5 years ago and 10 years ago, because God has given us a path forward. Look at verses 18 through 20. He says, come now, let us reason together. Oh, I love that right there. Too many folk in the church don't have any reason. You got to think. And he says, don't reason with him. Don't reason with her. Let's reason together. We've got to put our mind with God. That's what he's saying. He's not, Isaiah's not saying reason with me. No, he's saying reason with God. When we think with God, the Holy Spirit will lead us to revelation that we can't get on our own or from somebody else. That's why Paul says, let this mind be in you that is in who? Christ Jesus. Be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by a renewing of your mind. I've been preaching to you for 10 years, and you know, I don't give you Twinkie sermons full of sugar and fluff. We go deep because I want you to not only have a spiritual experience, but to have an intellectual experience so that you can reason and articulate your faith and not just come to worship as a robot, but know why you worship. When I was in seminary at Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary, one of the things they taught us is faith has to seek understanding. In other words, don't check your mind at the door. Bring your intellect into the church. Isaiah is saying, let us reason together. Let us reason with God. Let us put our thinking caps on and get into the mindset of God. Because it says through the Lord, your sins are like scarlet. They shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Somebody say, willing and obedient. Somebody type into the chat, willing and obedient. See, church, you have to want to be good. You have to want to be good. Falling into evil is easy, but it takes a willing and an obedient spirit to shun evil and gravitate towards good. When you're driving and somebody cuts you off, you got to want to be good, because you can fall into evil real quick. And when you cut somebody else off and they honk their horn and they're calling you everything but a child of God, and you have the resolve to just keep on keeping on. See, sometimes life will put you in a situation where you have to consciously decide to shun evil and to do good. But the text says that takes a willing and an obedient spirit. Israel retained its religious identity. Israel retained its ritual practices, but still fell into evil. There was no good in them, and therefore there was no validity in their worship and in the sacrifices that they offered up to God. Sister Richardson, the song was not yet written, but my Holy Ghost imagination tells me that if it were, Israel would have done well to sing, what if God is unhappy with our prayers? What if he is not pleased with the words we say? What if he takes away his love and his spirit from above? What if God is unhappy with our prayers? Then the songwriter says we must change the way we walk. We must change the way we talk. We must live a life that's pleasing to our King. We must read God's holy word and let his praises be heard. Lord, just be pleased with our prayers. Lord, we prepare the bulletin. Lord, we've written out our sermon. Lord, we practiced our songs. Lord, we laid out the altar. Lord, we vacuumed the sanctuary. Lord, we have the ushers on duty. Lord, we know the ritual. Lord, we know what we are going to do by The musical scale only goes up to G. But if you want to praise him in J flat, hallelujah. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. I'm looking over here somewhere. But I'm going to be willing and obedient and try to do good. Amen. That ought to be our prayer on this first Sunday of August. Because shortly here in the sanctuary, we're going to partake in the sacrament of Holy Communion. And Holy Communion is more than just a first Sunday ritual. Because Holy Communion is a memorial feast that gives us the blessed assurance that our sins are forgiven by Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Because Jesus is the perfect, holy, and living sacrifice who offered himself up on the cross once for all so that the stain of our sins would be washed away. And we who are sinners, we who are unworthy to offer up unto God any sacrifice, we come to this altar today not trusting in our own righteousness, but rather we trust in God's righteousness, whose property is always to have mercy. In the pulpit today, you have three pastors, myself, Reverend Dixon, and Dr. Floyd. All three of us have had long backgrounds in the Roman Catholic Church. Reverend Dixon was raised Roman Catholic, and Dr. Floyd and I were educated in the Roman Catholic Church. And if you've ever gone to Mass, there's a point in the Mass where the priest will say to the congregation, "Pray, my brothers and sisters, that your sacrifice and mine may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father." And the congregation will respond, "May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church." See, church, we don't come here presuming that we belong here, but we come here humbly knowing that we knocked on God's door. And one more time, God heard our knock. And he said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and eat with him and he with me." I'm glad today that God through Jesus Christ has washed me up, that God through Jesus Christ has cleaned me up, that God through Jesus Christ has put me back together again from brokenness so that I can come to this table one more time and break the bread and lift the cup, knowing that while I was yet a sinner, Jesus died for me. So we do well this morning, church, to be washed, not just with soap and water, but washed by the waters of our baptism and washed in the blood of Jesus. Well, the songwriter had it right when he said, "There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that blood lose all their guilty stains." St. John, I've said all that to you this morning to simply leave you with this. God commands, this is not a recommendation, God commands us to shun filth, he commands us to seek cleanliness, and he commands us to live a new life in him. So we thank God today for the prophet Isaiah, who spoke to the people on behalf of God and said to them, "Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean." But we also thank God on this first Sunday for Jesus Christ. Christ who died, Christ who's risen, and Christ who shall come again. We thank God today for Jesus, whose blood is sufficient for our salvation, yesterday, today, and forever. Thank God that you're not where you used to be. Thank God you're not what folks used to say about you. Thank God that you've been washed, that you've been made clean, and that you can come today by the blood of Jesus and offer a sacrifice of praise that is acceptable to Almighty God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
The sermon today was so powerful. Now, I want us to understand that God always kind of gives us a chance to turn around. We need Jesus. Is anyone here in the room and inside here at this building need somebody to pray for them? You need to talk to the pastor. You need to come forward. We have a pastor in my right and my left, myself, that can pray for you. Anyone that listen, watching this broadcast, you need a church. People across and called St. John, or send a note to St. John African Methodist Episcopal Church, 2261 East 40 Street, Cleveland, Ohio, 44103. Or you can call us, 216-431-560. Somebody can begin to contact you. This is a church of God. This is a church that believes that Christ is still doing miracles, that God is still accepting all those that repent and come to Him. Let us pray. My Heavenly Father, I just ask you, we just come and we just ask you, and we just come to you with a humble heart. We repent of all of our sin. We're looking for your guidance. We're looking for that moment when we turn around and start following the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Leaving all the past behind and just following you, Lord, to the good of ourselves, our soul, and our children. Help us to turn around and do whatever is holding us. Break that chain and bring it to us. Is anyone here or in the broadcast listen to this prayer and pray with us? I will tell you something. God will turn around your life. And whatever you do in the past, you stay in the past. The only thing you have to do is redeem yourself, clean yourself, and look for the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and walk with Him. God is real, and He just waiting for us. Amen? Amen.
We stand and come this far by faith. Thank you. Flowers. Men's and Women's Day is underway. Preparations are being made, and we want to thank those of you who have committed to helping us with the supplies and the food. Please get those donations in, and to remember to work on your Men's and Women's Day offering, $300 in September, and we thank God in advance for your support. GCC, we have a monthly team meeting on August the 11th, and the steward and trustee boards will meet August the 13th. GCC also has a stop trial, jail before trial. That information is below, and you may see Sister McKinney as well as the doses for COVID in various locations around the county, and the Alcohol, Drug, and Mental Health Services Board of Cuyahoga County is here to help persons in need. Let us now stand for our closing song. Be with you now, henceforth, and forevermore. Friends and YouTube congregation, God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us today. Have a great rest of the day, a great week, and we look forward to seeing you again on next Sunday at 10 o'clock. Until then, be safe and be blessed. Goodbye.